Let us pray. Spirit of living God, in strong hand, each person from us, Father, Lord, we ask, Lord, that you open our hearts, our souls, and our minds, give us wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. To understand the Logos Rhema word, which is a living, written word by you. Father, understanding that this is the only way that we're gonna make it to everlasting life. So, Father, you've given us direction. Now prepare our hearts to receive the bread of life and the water that we'll never thirst by, that we may stand in your expectations of this day, proclaiming what you've asked us to do in the name of Jesus. Amen, amen. Amen. We want to turn your Bibles to Revelation, the first chapter, and we want to pinpoint some things here. But while you're turning your Bibles to Revelation, the first chapter, I need to tell you some things. And that one, the number one first thing is, the Bible is evidence of God's truth. The Bible is evidence of God's truth, and not only will it set you free, but it is also 23 to 25% prophecy, which gives you the power to prepare for what God is going to do. It gives you power to prepare for what God is going to do. So prophecy is the, in the Bible is 23 to 25% of the Bible. It's because God says, I do nothing unless I warn my servant. He always tells his people what he's going to do so that they will not be surprised when it comes upon the rest of the world like a thief in the night. Nothing God is doing should come upon the church that's studying, that is a disciple of Jesus Christ and his doctrine, and him crucified and resurrected. Nothing that happens in the earth realm should be a surprise to the church. They should always be prepared. Okay. So now, reason why we are doing this study is because we want to look at something called the second advent. Now, the second advent is not the first coming of Jesus to the earth, but the second coming of how he's going to come back. We don't want to document the second coming of Jesus by a denomination. We don't want to document it by a man or a woman. We want to go into the Word of God, and we want to show you how Jesus is going to come back, when he's going to come back, and how God documents it from the Bible. So that when people begin to tell you he's coming at any time now, you will know that that's false. Because God does not lie against his word. God sets things in chronological order, in seasons, and God's word is disciplined. And in order for God to discipline us by his word, his word has to be disciplined. It can't contradict, it can't lie, it cannot be unfaithful. Because if the word of God was unfaithful, or if the word of God was a lie, there's no use of us believing in it. So he absolutely does what he says he's going to do. Matter of fact, his word is so binding that he said not one jot or one tittle of it would fall to the ground. These things are important to say because the way you respond to information is either you can respond to the truth or you can respond to a lie. If you take a lie and respond to it and live it as the truth, and it's not truth, but you will pay for it. So we want to see what God has to say. So the first important key is Revelation 1:10. Revelation 1:10. And it's talking about John the Revelator, and it reads as John 1:10, Revelation 1:10, Revelation 1:10, I'm sorry, Revelation 1:10. I was in the spirit on the Lord's day and heard behind me a great voice as of a thunder. 11 says, saying, I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, and what thou seest, write in a book and send it unto the seven churches, which are in Asia, Oedipus, unto Smyrna, Pergamos, unto the Tyre, unto Sardis, Philadelphia, unto Laodicea. So, he's saying, and let me stop right here and explain this to you. He's saying, number one, in 1:10, he said, I was in the spirit. So, in other words, he was not in the flesh, but God was spiritually showing John the Revelator something. And so, therefore, God took John the Revelator in a vision in the spirit of God to a future event called the Lord's Day. What we need to understand about the Lord's Day is the Lord's Day is the second advent describing to the hearer, the believer, the saint, what God is going to do approaching the Lord's Day. So he gave John a vision to understand what was going to be happening approaching that day. Now I can understand if John was the only one he gave the revelation to, then I can understand we could be confused. But he did not only give the revelation to John, he gave it to Daniel, he gave it to Zechariah, he gave it to Matthew, he gave it to Mark, he gave it to Luke, he gave it to Paul, he gave it to Peter. So there is, should be no confusion about how we get the understanding of what's going to happen approaching the day of the Lord. See, because approaching the day of the Lord is what's going to be something called an hour of temptation. The reason why the day of the Lord and the hour of temptation is so important is because the hour of temptation is going to be called tribulation. It's going to be testing time. And the very powers of heaven are going to be shaken. Most people are going to get in bed with a lie right out the bat, because their denomination, their pastor, their teacher are going to preach that Jesus is going to come and fly us out of here. But the Bible does not say Jesus is going to come twice. It says he's going to come by once. So we want to document that. So we're right here in Revelation 1:10 and 11. And he says in 11, said, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. And what thou seest, write in a book and send it unto the seven churches, which in Asia. Okay, now, listen at that. He said, I am the Alpha and the Omega. He says, I'm the beginning. Let's look at that, Alpha. When he came to the earth as Savior, he was the beginning of what God was going to do with mankind. He was the beginning of restoration of mankind. He was the beginning of people being reconciled to what they were supposed to be in Genesis 1, 26 and 27. Jesus came to redeem the Omega, which means he's coming back. When he comes back, everything between the Alpha, which is the beginning, and everything between the end, he controls. He controls it in your hearing. And if you want to be a part of what he's doing, you're going to have to get on board with not what man says, not what your pastor says, not what your denomination says. If you want to be a part of what the saints and the believers are doing through Jesus Christ, you got to get on board with what this says. Okay, now, this is very important that I set this foundation, because I'm going to start the roll in a minute. So we're going to go to Revelation 5. And when we get to Revelation 5, remember that this is the book called Revelation, which means the unveiling. When you get to Revelation 5, you notice he told John to write it in the book and send it to the seven churches in Revelation 1:11. He told John, he said, now that you are standing in the Lord's Day, now that you are standing in the future, I want you to write down what I'm showing you, so that you can give it to the church, so that they will understand how times are going to be as they approach this day. So I want you to record it. And I don't want you to give it to just anybody. He said, I want you to give it to the church. Revelation 5 is key to that, because I want you to understand that a denomination, a man, can't open your mind. The same one that had to open the vision to show it to John the Revelator is the only one going to be able to open your hearing to hear it. See, so the same one that gave the vision of the approaching day of the Lord to John is the only one that can open your mind to hear it. Satan don't want y'all to know this. Satan don't want people to know. See, because the church has preached that God is good. First, the church has preached Noah's day. The church has preached Moses' day. But nobody seems to know how this thing is going to wind up. So we're gonna travel into this word. So listen at what it says. I want to prove the reason why I'm here. I want to prove the point that only Jesus can give you revelation. And I saw at the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the backside sealed with seven seals. Seven seals is important. You need to write that. The seven seals are important because seven seals are only the understanding of the seven visions that John is going to explain coming up to the day of the Lord. The seven seals are seven visions of wisdom and understanding that John was told by God to give you so that you would understand what things were going to look like. So when you look, when you read this word and Jesus opens it to you, and you look at it, you see it, you will say, wow, that's what Jesus told John to tell me. So now, we got the document that it's only Jesus is going to be able to open your mind. So I'm going to speed up. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the book that I gave John? Who is worthy to open their mind to the book that I told John to give to the church? 3, no man in heaven, nor in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book, neither to look therein. And I wept, because no man was found worthy to open the, and to read the book, neither to look therein. And one of the elders said unto me, weep not. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has prevailed to open the book and to loose, listen to that, that word loose, to loose the seven seals thereof, which means to loose the wisdom, to loose the understanding of what's in the book, of what I told him to write to you. So Jesus is going to loose your mind to what he told his servant to write. I'm only teaching it. I'm only preaching it. But I'm going by the Bible. So now, it says, and behold, 6, and I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne of the four beasts, and in the midst of the elders stood a lamb. That documents that this is Jesus. As it had been slain, having seven horns, which means authority, seven eyes, and you know seven is God's number, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth unto all the earth. So he has seven spirits sent forth to all the earth. Okay, now we've got an understanding that John is standing in the second coming of Jesus. Now we've got an understanding that he's given this vision to John and told John to write it and called it the book of Revelation. Now we understand that in this book of Revelation, coming up to the day of Jesus, there are going to be seven visions that he's going to give us in Revelation 6. Each one of these visions are going to happen. Chronologically, they are not in order, but we're going to put them in order for the hearer. So we're going to rightly divide and understand how this thing is going to come about. So we're going to go to Revelation 6 so we can deal with seven seals. Now I want you to understand seven means something because seven is God's number. Not 6, not 5, not 4. 7 is spiritually complete. So Jesus won't come back till 7. That's spiritually complete. Okay, so now, when we go into Revelation 6, watch this. And I saw when the Lamb, which is Jesus, opened one of the seals. What are these opening? He says he's opening one of them. So he's been to paint a vision in your mind. He's been to paint wisdom and revelation in your mind. So he says, when he opened one of the seals, I heard as it were the noise of thunder, one of the four beasts saying, come and see. And I saw and behold a white horse. Okay, this is going to be important. We're going to see a lot here in a minute, but I'm going to finish reading this. And I saw and behold a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow. And a crown was given unto him, And he went for conquering and to conquer. We need to get an understanding that this person on this white horse is not Jesus. But now I also need for you to understand Jesus rides a white horse too. Look at Revelation 19, 11 through 13. We want to describe the white horse Jesus gonna ride. Revelation 19, 11 through 13. Revelation 19, 11 through 13, when you got to say amen. Revelation 19, 11. And I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse. And he that sat upon him was called faithful and true and righteous. He does judge and make war. His eyes are as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. His name on this white horse is called the Word of God. You notice the white horse on that first seal, he's got a bow in his hand. Huh? And he says he's going forth to conquer. It says he's going forth to conquering and to conquer. Now, we need to understand and get a revelation from this, what is happening with this guy on this white horse that's riding this white horse. And so when you actually realize the guy that's riding the white horse, you can go back in the Bible in this first seal and understand that this white horse is being mentioned in Matthew 4:5. So let's go back there. Matthew 24:4-5. And Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. This white horse is going forth to conquer and to conquer. He's going to do it by coming in Christ's name to deceive, conquering by deception and conquering. So now we're gonna discuss this. So when you look at Revelation 6:1-2, you can bridge it back to Matthew 4:5, and you can understand that this first horse with the bow is coming, riding a white horse, looking like Jesus. The only difference in the horse that he's riding in him is he's got a bow in his hand, which means he's coming to wage war. But we need to ride and divide this thing now. So because the bow that he got in his hand, Paul 6 says that it's fiery darts. So in the evil day, in his trickery, he's gonna ride a white horse looking like Jesus, but he got a bow with fiery darts to shoot deception in your mind. So Ephesians 6 says, put on all the armor so that you can, so the fiery darts of Satan, the fiery darts and the wiles and the trickery of Satan is he's coming on a horse like Jesus in 2 Thessalonians, the 2nd chapter, 1 through 11, which says he's coming and he's going to stand in the temple calling himself Jesus, where he ought not to be. But then here's the severity of him coming. Second Corinthians. The severity of him coming is he's masquerading himself, riding a horse like, masquerading himself as Jesus. See, this is why this is so diabolical, is because the church now, with a hope and with a faith, is waiting on Jesus to come. The thing about it is, 1 Corinthians 15:50. The thing about it is, Jesus is not going to come till the last trump, which is 7. Remember that we wrote? So the last trump is 7. So now,
The hour of temptation is going to come.
Listen what I say.
The hour of temptation is going to come.
Listen what I say.
The hour of temptation is going to come when 666 rolls around and he comes and stands in the earth realm with his white horse and with his bow, going into the church, standing in the place Jesus ought to be standing, saying, "I'm Jesus." His apostles and his prophets that are liars, that God did not make or even ordain them as messengers, are setting the stage for the Antichrist right now.
Let me roll on because I got a lot of information to pour out.
So now, when you look at Revelation 6, 3, and 4, when you look at Revelation 6, 3, and 4, it says, when he had opened the second seal, and I heard the second beast say, "Come and see." And there went out another horse that was red, and power was given unto him that sat thereon to take peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another, and there was given unto him a great sword. Go back to Matthew 6 and 7. Matthew 24, 6 and 7. Go back to Matthew 24, 6 and 7. Matthew 24, 6 and 7 said, "And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must." All these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famine, pestilence, and earthquakes in the land, in divers places. Do you get what I'm saying? That's the second seal. Matthew 24, 6 and 7 is describing the second seal. Okay. Now, keep in mind, keep writing this note. We're looking at what's going to happen approaching before Jesus ever sets his feet back on the earth called the day of the Lord. We didn't approve that, but just stick with me because I want to paint this picture for you a minute. Now, what you need to understand, this next writing is very, 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 very important. This next seal, this third seal, Revelation 6, 5. And when he had opened the third seal, I heard the third beast say, "Come and see." And I beheld as though a black horse, and he that sat on him had a pair of balances in his hands. He had a set of balances in his hands, which means famine. Okay, so we want to go back to Revelation 7 again. Revelation 7, Matthew 24. Oh, 7, I'm sorry. Matthew 24. I mean, 7. Now listen to what he said. For nation shall rise against nation. So therefore, the second shield and that horse in the second shield is going to be working. And then there shall be famine. So that means the third seal, that black horse is going to be riding with the red horse. Because it says in Matthew 24:7, for nation shall rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. So the first horse and the second seal is going to be riding, and also the black horse is going to be riding because famine and pestilence and earthquakes in godless places. But right here in Matthew 24:7, I need to go a bit far about the famine. So therefore, I need you to turn back to Amos 8:11. And Amos is a minor prophet, so therefore it is prophecy, so therefore it is preparation for you. So when you get to Amos 8, this is talking about another famine. So when you get to Amos, it talks about a famine of hearers of the word of God. So not only is there going to be physical famine that you can see, but there's going to be a spiritual famine from people not hearing the truth. So all this again is approaching Jesus' second coming. I need you to understand. Now, we need to cover the neck. And I heard in the midst of the four beasts saying, a measure of wheat for a barley, and three measures of barley for a penny, and see that thou hurt not the oil and the wine, which is the anointed of God. And when he had opened the fourth seal, and I heard a voice, and I heard the voice of the fourth beast say, come and see. And I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and his name that sat on him was Death, and hell followed with him. And power was given unto him over the fourth part of the earth to kill with sword, and with hunger, and with death, and with the beast of the earth. That's the fourth seal. So now, pestilence we're right back at Matthew 24:7. Pestilence. This is approaching Jesus' second coming. That's why it's called the hour of temptation. So now, therefore, when you look, is there any, have we seen any pestilence? Do you know what pestilence means? A contagious disease. You ain't seen it on the earth, have you? Or there's one on the earth now. So we are approaching the day of the Lord, but we are chronologizing the order of how it's going to approach and what we're going to be able to look out and see. Oh, it's going to get better in a minute. I'm just taking my time so I can show you that what Revelation is saying about these seals, Matthew, Mark 13, Matthew 24, Mark 13, Luke 21 gives confirmation to what Revelation 6 is showing you that's going to come approaching that day. That's why it's called the hour of temptation, because anybody in the earth realm going to be tried to still live. Okay, so now, we're going to go down to 6:9, and we want to look at that fifth seal. We're going to look at that fifth seal at 6:9, Revelation 6:9. Now, we are at the fifth seal, so we only got 2 months. And then we can run. And when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain. You know, John, Isaiah, Paul. Do you know all 12 of Jesus' apostles suffered violent death?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, watch this. For the word of God, listen, let me read this again. And when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? The ones that dwell on the earth, Lord, is the one that did this to us. It's talking about mortal. So we want to go back the Matthew 24, 8 through 28. Matthew 24, 8 through 28. Listen to what he says. Matthew 24, 8. And these are the beginning of sorrows. Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted and shall kill you. And ye shall be hated of all nations. Why should we be hated? For his name's sake. Then it says, then shall many be offended and shall betray one another and shall hate one another. And many false prophets shall arise and shall deceive many. This is approaching. He said, many false prophets shall arise and deceive many. And because iniquity, which means sin, shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. He goes on to say, but he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. That's important. You need to put a star beside that. Because, see, The end ain't coming till the gospel been preached. So ain't no man can stand and tell you that he's coming at any time, because the gospel has not reached to the end of the earth. Okay, we're going to go forward. When ye therefore shall see, this is good right here. When ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, whosoever read it, let him understand. Now, we need to stop right there at Selah, because Matthew 24:15 is talking about that first rider on that white horse with that bow, standing where he ought not to be, firing his bow to deceive the church, telling all people, I'm Christ. And they're going to get in bed at 6, because the first horse with the bow is coming at 6, 6, 6, and we are approaching 6, 6, 6. So we are in the bottom of 5, 5, 5. So we are approaching 6, 6, 6. So when he says, when ye therefore shall see, if Jesus were going to rapture us out of the world, we wouldn't be able to see.
Amen.
Would we? Mm-hmm. Oh, it's going to get better. It's going to get better. Follow me as we. So now, he said, then let them which be in Judea flee into the mountains. Let him which is in the housetop not come down to take anything out of his house. Neither let him which is in the field return back to take his clothes. Listen to what it said. 19 is another key point. Woe unto them that are with child, and to them that give suck in those days. Now, this is important. You need to tie in 15, Matthew 24:15, and Matthew 19, because the abomination of desolation, which is Satan standing where he ought not to be. Satan ain't got no business standing in a Christian's heart with falseness when Jesus stands in a Christian heart with truth. When Jesus has given the Christian the spirit of truth, there is no way that you should let Satan sit in your heart with a bunch of falseness, sitting up under a bunch of false prophets and a bunch of false apostles, teaching you from their belly and not preparing you for what's going on. Because see, Jesus told John the Revelator, he said, I want you to write 7 visions. I don't want you to write just 3 visions and preach the 3 visions. I want you to teach it all. So what we're doing today is we're painting a picture of everything that's going to happen. So therefore, he's saying in Matthew 15, he said, when you see Jesus, when you see that false Jesus standing where he ought not to be, that's what the abomination of desolation of Daniel was talking about. When you see this false Jesus standing where he ought not be, Jesus don't know if you got in bed with him, because you're going to be carrying a baby called deception. You're going to took that false doctrine about he going to rapture you out of here, and Jesus done told you, I ain't coming back to seven. Right. Let's prove that. 1 Corinthians 15. Then we're coming back to Matthew. 1 Corinthians 15. Boy, I've got to speed up. 1 Corinthians 15, watch this. Look at 50. 1 Corinthians 15, 50. We got the document. Now, again, you need to understand the key to it is they 7 different visions, 7 different trumpets, 7 vials, 7 spirits. So have you got on yet that 7 is God's number, which means spiritually complete? Huh? So 7 will be the last trump, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
I need to clarify that. 7 is the last trump. So you got that? Okay, now, if you ain't got that yet, you need to talk to me, because this is important. That last trump is important for what we've been to read. Watch what it says, 50. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Neither does corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. He's showing it to you through the intellect of your ears, that your spiritual eyes may see. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. When will we be changed? The last trumpet. Is that what it said? Okay, watch this. If he comes at 7, and if 6 in mathematical order comes before 7, and you receive that doctrine of he's coming to fly us away and get in bed with him. When Jesus comes, you're supposed to be a chaste virgin, betrothed to Jesus. And betrothed is binding as marriage. So if betrothed is binding as marriage, for you to get in bed with anybody else, according to Jewish laws, is death. So if he come and find you a child, ain't nobody gonna have to tell him you ain't no. Ain't nobody gonna have to tell him you ain't no virgin no more, because you want me to tell you what a child gonna do? He's gonna leave a spiritual mark on you. It's called the mark of the beast. You're gonna be looking at yourself and going, look at my scratch marks. And your baby deception gonna be 15, 20, 30 years old. Because sooner you've been in church that long. Right. On that false doctrine, you've been pregnant so long, you done had that baby. And when Jesus come and said, you got a 30-year-old baby named Deception, I know you ain't claiming to be a virgin. Mm-hmm. Okay, let's move on. Mm-hmm. He said, and woe to them that are milk child, and to them that give suck in those days. But pray ye that your flight be not in the winter, neither on the Sabbath day. Listen to this. This is real important. Okay. Number 21 is real important. Okay. Matthew 24:21 is real important. Listen how he words this. Even a baby can understand this. Listen to this. For then shall the great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, nor ever shall be. Except those days should be shortened, there should be no flesh be saved. But for the elect's sake, those days shall be shortened. Now let me explain why that's important.
Matthew 24:22.
21 says, and then shall be great tribulation, such as not since the beginning of the world to this time. No, nor ever shall be. Now, why would Jesus have to cut the time short for his elect's sake if he were going to come in and fly us out before the hour of temptation called the tribulation? If he was going to fly us out, why would Jesus have to come and cut the time short?
Because
we're going through the tribulation. Because there's a chance that if we don't read the report, that we'll get in bed with 34,000 labels. We'll get in bed with the false apostle and the false prophet, and many coming in his name proclaiming to be him, but not able to tell you the truth about God's word. If they're preaching anything, and they're not preaching to keep you on truth, and you got no clue how we're going to approach Jesus, and we're close to his season, how are you going to stand on and live by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God when you've gotten all the way to the most to the finish line and all of a sudden you find yourself not knowing what's going to happen approaching the day of the Lord? You're going to get caught with child. You're going to get in bed with something. And I don't know how old your baby going to be when he comes back. That's on you and him. So now, if any man shall say, listen to what he said, this is what he said. If any man shall say unto you, lo, here is Christ, or there, believe it, and he said, believe it not.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Huh? Because when Christ comes, every eye go see him. For there shall arise false Christ, false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders. Insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. Now listen, here's why we should be, the church of today should be ashamed Listen to how he worded this. Behold, I have foretold you before. Wherefore, if they shall say unto you, behold, he is in the desert, go not forth. Behold, he is in the secret chambers. Believe it not. For as the lightning cometh out of the east and shineth even unto the west, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Is that what he said? He said, like the lightning in the sky, everybody sees it. So now let me ask you a question. The people said when the rapture come, you just gonna get missing. Jesus said, when I come, ain't gonna be no question. Everybody gonna see me. So how you gonna get missing, Mr. Jeff, and say you live with Jesus, and everybody else ain't seen Jesus? That bullet Satan is shooting is messed up some minds. He's shooting it already. Okay, so now I gotta get to 28 because I got one more. 28. For whosoever the carcass is, there will be eagles to gather together. Now listen, listen, I got to go one more. I got to get 29. He said, immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of heaven shall be shaken. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. Now listen to what he said in 29. He said, immediately after
the tribulation.
Y'all get me?
Yes. Amen.
You got it?
Yes, sir.
So now, we're going back to Revelation 6:20. And Revelation 6:12 says, simple as this, Revelation 6:12. And I behold, when he had opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood, and the stars of heaven fell unto earth, even, listen to what he's saying, even as, listen to what he's saying, even as a fig tree casteth her untimely figs. That's on the sixth. That's on the sixth seal.
Yes,
untimely figs. When she is shaken of a mighty wind. These figs are no good. They are untimely. And the heaven departed as a scroll, and when it is rolled together, and every mountain and every island were moved out of their places. Let me explain. The heaven, the earth is off its axis because of the curse. When God comes back, he's going to restore the earth. Watch this. And the kings of the earth and the great men and the rich men and the chief captains and the mighty men and every bondsman and every free man hid themselves in the den and in the rocks of the mountain. I guess so. You're carrying that baby called deception, or you done added one. And said to the mountains and rock, fall on us, hide us from the face of him that sit on the throne, and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? When you go back to Matthew 24:29, through 30, listen to what he said. Immediately after the tribulation of another day shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall give up her light. And then I'm gonna summarize it. 30. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. He said immediately after the tribulation. Now we need to pinpoint that it's saying on that sixth seal, immediately after the tribulation. Go to 2 Thessalonians. Second Thessalonians, second chapter. Second Thessalonians, second chapter. Listen to what he says. 2 Thessalonians 2nd chapter. We're going to start at 3. 2 Thessalonians 2nd chapter. We're going to start at 3. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. So now here we talk about that man, the son of perdition. It says, let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposed and exalt himself above all that is called God or that is worshiped, so that he as God, listen to how that worded it, so that he as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. This is it. Remember. Remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things, and now ye know that we're holy, that he might be revealed in his time. His time is 666. He said he's going to withhold so he can be revealed in his time. His time is 666. Watch this. For the mystery of iniquity does already work. Only he who now let it will let until he be taken out of the way. He said, I'm going to let him have his time till he be taken out of the way. How is he going to be taken out of the way? How is he going to be taken out of the way? I'm glad he asked. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy. Listen, this is why we're here. And shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. He says, I'm going to take 666 out of the way. I'm going to take that hour of temptation out of the way. I'm going to take the days of vengeance out of the way. I'm going to take Jacob's sorrows out of the way when I come. Did you get that?
Yeah.
So coming up to Jesus coming back, all the things that we have described is going to be happening in the earth realm, but the severity of what's going to be happening in the earth realm is Satan deceiving people with his apostles, with his ministers, with his churches, and the only one that's been a thing to build a church from Genesis to Revelation, Matthew 16, is Jesus Christ. So if you invade it with any other doctrine, any other Jesus, you're going to carry a child. You're not going to be impregnated and set free with truth because you're going to be received a lie. That means you didn't put your armor on, because when that white horse rode through your mind, he shot you with his dart and poured the wiles, which means the trickery. He took the trickery, and instead of you getting in the armor and being disciplined to put the armor on, oh, I don't believe I need to do all that. And that dart came and shot you, and next thing you know, you stand up, yeah, my pastor's prophet, so-and-so. And when you spit that out of your mouth, you showing you carrying that baby right there. Because my God is Jesus. My doctrine is the gospel.
That's right.
My news is him crucified and resurrected. And he's the only one that can keep my mind stable when the powers of heaven are going to be shaken. The only one that can keep your mind stable is Jesus. Now, Mark 13, 24 through 25, you can write this. You ain't got to go there. Mark 13, 24 through 25. It tells you immediately after the tribulation. Luke 21, 22, 23 through 23. The days of vengeance after the tribulation. Mark 13, 17 without child. Matthew 24 with child. Matthew 24, 19 talks about being with tribes. Luke 21, 26 talks about the power of heaven being shaken. Now, the problem is, we need to look at something. We need to go to Revelation, and we need to look at Revelation 3. We're going to need to look at Revelation 3:7 when you got to say amen.
Knock, 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 knock. Lord, open up the ears all over the sound, up under the sound of my voice, that they may hear you speaking. Because the only way that they're going to get this is that they have spiritual ears to hear, that they may become overcomers to rise above all this false teaching that Satan is doing in these churches. Listen to what he said to Philadelphia. Philadelphia is a church. And John gave the revelation to Philadelphia. Listen to it real good. And to the angel of the church of Philadelphia write, these things said he that is holy, he that is true, he that has the key of David, he that opened it and no man shut it, and shut it and no man opened it. Who are you talking about?
Jesus.
Jesus. Okay, watch this. Okay, that's good. David talking about Jesus. Watch this. I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, salvation, and no man can shut it. For thou hast a little strength and has kept my word. That's important. He says, y'all have a little strength and have kept my word and has not denied my name. You have kept my word.
Yes.
You have received my word.
Yes.
You have acted upon my name. And you have not denied me. So let's see what he said. He going to say, watch this.
Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not. Those that say they are this and they that and are not. He said they do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet and to know that I have loved thee. Because you have kept.
Okay, I got to move on. I got to move on. I got to move on.
Because, number 10, because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation. He said, now, the requirements that I will keep you is because you have kept my word and you have not denied my name. So here's what he promised. Because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. So do you understand what I just got from that? Tribulation, the shaking of the powers of heaven, is to try mankind. Tribulation is to try you. It's a refiner's fire, Zechariah 13, 17 and 18. It's to try you. Let us go. Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. Wonder why he's saying, hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. See, because there's so much false teaching.
That's what it is, deception.
That people are impregnating people with false ideas. The TV is doing it every day. He sits in front of Fox News, and all over the airways. I'm not going to get out on that, but I want to show the principle that when you got somebody, if faith comes by hearing, if faith comes by hearing the truth of the word of God and it builds your faith in God, what's going to happen if you keep listening every day to some lies? Pretty soon, if you ain't got Jesus to defend your mind, you're going to be absorbed by every day, everywhere you look, over the airwaves, over the radio, over the newspaper. So if faith comes by hearing and you hearing a lie, you will become a part of the lie to the point that there are 1.5 million people in Steele County that hear the call of Q. Mm-hmm. I've been looking at Q all my life. They never knew it had no power.
Okay.
So now listen to what he said. Number 12. Him that overcomes. I will make a pillar. This is the five wise virgins.
Yes.
This is the five wise virgins. This is the five wise virgins. Why are they virgins? Because they didn't sleep with Satan. Yeah. Because they don't sleep with another Jesus and another spirit. Listen to what he said. Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out, and I will write upon him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God, and I will write upon him my new name. You hear what he said? Now, we need to get a look at if we hold on and we be still living when Jesus come back, we need to get a look at what the day of the Lord is going to look like. What Jesus is actually coming, because they say he's coming to fly you out. So they're saying Jesus is coming to the earth to take you out of the earth. According to Revelation 20, Jesus is coming with a whole different agenda. He's not coming to leave, at least not before 1,000 years. He's not coming to leave, at least for not 1,000 years. He's coming to earth to stay on the earth for 1,000 years. Let's let John the Revelator and Jesus open our mind to what exactly is Jesus going to do when he comes to the earth, Revelation 20. Revelation 20 says, and I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit and great chains in his hand. And he laid hold on that dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years. Let's go to, can somebody read me 2 Peter, the 3rd chapter in the 9th verse. 2 Peter, the 3rd chapter in the 9th verse. I'll go there. 2 Peter, the 3rd chapter in the 9th verse. We're up to the 8th verse. 2 Peter, the 3rd chapter. 2 Peter, the 3rd chapter in the 8th verse. But beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord 1,000 years. And 1,000 years as one day. So what is a day with the Lord? 1,000 years. Huh? That what Peter said? Oh, let's go back to Revelation 20 then. Listen to what he said. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years. So that means that when Satan is bound that 1,000 years, he gonna be standing where John was talking about in Revelation 1:10, and where John was talking about, I'm standing in the Lord's day. So in the Lord's day, John is still explaining to you that in that day of that 1,000 years, that one day of the Lord, here's what's gonna be going on. First thing gonna be going on is, I'm gonna destroy the Antichrist and his role when he comes. Second thing gonna be going on, I'm not gonna let Satan run around on the earth, tempting and destroying people. He said, I'm gonna bow him right off the bat. So now wait a minute. The people say he gonna come and just take people, but they saying when he comes, he gonna bow Satan for a thought. Why he gonna bow Satan if he coming to get you and leave? Why he gonna bow Satan if he coming to get you, his business, if he coming to rapture you out of here, is to come and get you and fly out so you won't go do what Satan is gonna put the rest of the earth through. But according to this, that's not true. According to this, his first business, bind Satan, the devil. Or he called out his name, the serpent. He called out his name. You see what I'm saying? So now, we're going to let the Bible tell us. Watch this. And cast him into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal upon him that he should not deceive. Listen to what it said. He that should not deceive the nations no more till the 1,000 years should be fulfilled. And after that, he must be loosed a little season. And I saw thrones. And they sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus. That means John didn't come. That means when Jesus come back to earth, how is Jesus coming back to earth to take people out of here when he brings John in with
him.
Y'all, is this resonating with y'all?
Yes.
To be the truth? Okay, watch this. He says, I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their forehead. Listen, I got to read that one more time. Let me slow down. I got to marinate in that like some chicken and some gravy. Listen to what he said. Listen to what he said. I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads. People talk about it's going to be a chip on your hand. He said the mark is going to be in your forehead. What's in your forehead?
Your brain.
What's in your forehead?
That's the mark.
The mark of deception. Your brain is going to be deceived. That's going to be the mark. It ain't going to be no chip. The mark is going to be your mind being deceived. That's going to be the mark. You're going to get on a lie instead of having some way but opportunity to be on the truth and not be deceived. Okay, watch this. Are in their hands, and they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. Oh, so Christ is coming to earth, and he going to reign on earth 1,000 years? That can't be true, because they told me that he going to come and fly us out of here swiftly. He going to be so swift that you going to get missing, and they ain't going to know you're gone until they go to look for you. Okay, I'm going to move on. But the rest of the dead live not until 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is he that has part in the first resurrection. On such the second death has no power. The first resurrection. You remember in the 10 virgins, it said that by midnight, the darkest part, which means wickedness, at 12:01 is a new day, the cry came. Behold, he comes. You remember, the virgins got up. They went in. I said, they went in. They woke up out of their sleep and went in. They had enough to make it. They was anointed to make it. The other five, the foolish one, guess what happened then? They stopped learning at 666. Ain't usually you going into Revelation. That ain't for our time. You might well just listen to us teach you. Let man deceive you. Don't go into Revelation. He's coming in September. Go sell your houses and your cars and your boats. He's coming in September. Listen to man. And the first thing Jesus told him was, don't let man deceive you. This is the day. This right here documented for you. It'll equip you to be saved. If I'm not bringing it to you out of here, you ought not to have nothing to do with me. I don't care if you're a chief, Balabala, apostle, prophet, minister, preacher, teacher, elder, deacon, trust person, lay person. I don't care who you is. If you ain't giving it out of here and you don't know the plan of God, every person in your synagogue, in your church, blood will be on your hand because you're not preparing them with prophecy. And the power of prophecy is preparation. So that when he comes like a thief in the night, his saints will be strutting and looking and saying, I'm aware. I also know that's not Jesus over there. Because see, when Jesus comes at 777, the first thing I'm going to test myself with, they're going to say, oh, he over there in the desert on 7. That's not him.
Yes.
Because when he comes, I'm changing. I'm going to be all spirit again.
Amen.
See, that's the first sign. When they come and say, well, I saw him over there doing lying, signs, and wonders, I'm going to say, wait a minute, let me test myself. That's not him. That's not him. Okay, let's go a step one. But when the 1,000 years are expired, listen, when the 1,000 years were expired, Satan would be loosed out of prison and shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four corners of the earth. Now, why is the 1,000 years he ain't gonna let Satan be loose to deceive no more? See, this is what you don't understand about the business of Jesus when he come to the earth. Jesus, John, Isaiah, and all the ones that have already left the earth realm are coming back to earth to teach for 1,000 years. Because a person that has never been in the truth cannot possibly be set free by the truth if they never heard truth. And all those people that are sitting in these false churches that has not heard truth, if God be a just and fair God, how can you explain to people that have never heard the truth had a fair chance? If Jesus went all the way back to Noah's time to make sure that they heard the truth, it would only be fair for the rest of the world to hear the truth too. So it was so important to God to save people through grace that he told Jesus, when they put you in the tomb, I don't want you to lay there and rest. I want you to get up. I want you to give all those people that could have been saved through grace, unmerciful grace. I want you to preach to them, and if they receive grace, I want you to bring them to heaven. So how would it be fair to a just God to let a people sit in a church that ain't never heard truth, but been to sin in their heart to know truth, and ain't never heard truth because they let somebody lead them blind? Huh? So God, whose will is that all mankind would be saved, is going to teach for 1,000 years. Now, we ain't going to go into that this Sunday, but next Sunday or Tuesday or Thursday, we're going to break open what the duty of the 5 wise virgins is when Jesus come back on that 1,000 years. So far, we have proved that Jesus ain't coming back to a 7, 7, 7. So far, we have proved that coming up to 7, 7 day, 7, 7, 7, is going to be an hour of temptation. Now, I'm tired of hearing people talking about, well, we're going to heaven and we're going to stay for 7.5 years. I don't believe that's true. I don't believe that's true, because you know why? He told Philadelphia, he said, I'm going to eat, only keep you for 1 hour. Ain't that what he said? He said, I'm only going to keep you for 1 hour. So now, therefore, if he's only going to keep us for 1 hour in the hour of temptation, so if he's only going to keep us for 1 hour, let's look at Revelation 9. Sometimes I can't even read my own writing. Let's look at Revelation 9. Revelation 9:1 says this, and the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. And he opened the bottomless pit, and there arose a smoke out of the pit, as the smoke of a great furnace. And the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. And there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth. And to them was given power, as scorpions of the earth have power. And it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any fruit, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads. And to them it was given that they should not kill them, but that they should torment 5 months. And their torment was as the torment of a scorpion when he striketh a man. And in those days shall men seek death and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them. And the shape of the locust was like unto horses prepared unto battle, and on their heads were as it were crowns like gold, and their faces was as the faces of men. How many did he say? 5 months. He said 5 months. Okay. Let's go a step further. Let's look at Revelation 19. And they had tails like unto scorpions, and there were stings in their tails, and their power was to hurt men. How many months?
5 months.
And they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name is of Hebrew tomb is Abaddon, but in the Greek tomb has his name Apollyon. One woe is past, and behold, there afterward. And the sixth angel sounded, and I heard a voice from the four horns and the golden altar, which is before God, saying to the sixth angel which had the trumpet, loose the four angels which are bound in the great Euphrates. And the four angels were loosed, which were prepared for an hour, and a day, and a month, and a year, for to slay the third part of men. Watch this. Let's back up a minute. I'm going to show you something. Did you write that down? That's important for what we've been to go. Let's back up to 7 right here a minute. Let's look at 7. Watch this. Huh? Did you get what I just read on that last right there?
Yes, sir.
Hmm?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Okay, watch this. Number 7. And after these things, I saw four angels holding the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth. Holding the four winds. I'm in Revelation 7. I'm holding the four winds of the earth. We just got finished looking at them four winds being loose, didn't we?
No,
I'm in 7:1. Yeah, I'm in 7:1. Now, watch this. We just seen the four winds being loose from Euphrates, right? So time must have passed. Because now, right here, he's dealing with four winds. Okay, watch what he sees. Watch this. Holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, nor on the sea, nor on any tree. Why is he holding the four winds? And I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God. And he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea, saying, hurt not the earth, neither the sea, not the trees, till we have sealed the servants of God in their foreheads. So now, this is the fifth seal, or it's the time that God is saying, hold up, we're not going to let the fourth winds from the Euphrates hurt the land yet. Because I got to seal those that are mine. So, that's kind of ironic. Because Daniel had a dream. And that dream sickened him. But in Daniel's dream, now let me go back and see if I'm right. Daniel dreamed about our time. And when he says, let me hold up till I seal those that are mine, he simply says, Daniel 12:4. We're going to go to Daniel 12:1 and we're going to go to 4. Watch this. Daniel 12:1, we're going to 4. And at that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince which standeth for the children of thy people. And there shall be a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation, even to that same time. And at that time thy people shall be delivered, every one that shall be found written in the book. And many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. And they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the bright men. And they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever. Did you hear what he said? Those that turn people to righteousness, they're going to shine.
Yes, sir.
But listen to this. For is why we're here. But thou, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book. There go that seal again. Shut up the words and seal the book, even to the time of the end, when many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased. Knowledge shall be increased because God, just like he did Daniel, he gave Daniel knowledge of what was going to happen in our time. Revelation 7 says, hurt nothing until I have sealed those that are mine in their forehead. He wants you to understand how this thing is going to happen, because if you get in bed with the wrong one, your baby going to be deception. Now, Revelation 13, and this is my last stop. Here's what it says. Revelation 13, 5. No, I'm going to go forward. And they worshiped the dragon, which gave power to the beast. And they worshiped the beast, saying, who is like unto the beast?
Who is like
unto the beast? Who is able to make war with him? And there was given unto him a mouth, speaking great things and blaspheming. And power was given unto him to continue 42 months. And he opened his mouth. This is what this says. How did he do it? He opened his mouth and blasphemed against God, to blaspheme his name, his tabernacle, and them that dwell in heaven. And it was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. And power was given unto him over all kindreds and tongues and nations. And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain before the foundation of the world. If any man have an ear, let him hear. I hope you ain't caught in the famine. He that leadeth into captivity shall go into captivity. He that killeth with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and faith of the saints. And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb. He said he had two horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon. He had two horns like a lamb, so he was looking like a lamb, but his language was like a dragon. And it says, and he exercised all the power of the first beast before him, and caused the earth and them that dwell therein to worship the first beast whom deadly wind was healed. And he doeth great wonders, so that he made fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men, and deceived them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast. So now, if you really get what I'm saying, even the false Antichrist is not going to come to earth and say, I'm going to fly away. He's going to come to earth and stay on the earth to deceive people. So where is they getting that he's going to come and turn around and go back? Where are they getting that theory from? Where are you getting that theory from? That Jesus is going to come, pick up some people, and turn around and fly back. Because even the Antichrist is coming before Jesus, and he's not going to come and fly back. He's going to stay in the earth realm, deceiving and conquering and being conquered. Okay, watch this. Deceiving them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles which he had power to do, in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth, that they should make an image to the beast, which had the wound by his sword, did live. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And he caused all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their, you know, your right hand is God's hand.
That's right.
Yeah. Here is wisdom. No, I got 17. And that no man might buy or sell, save he that had the mark of the name of the beast or the name of his name. Here is wisdom. Let him that has understanding count the number of the beast. For it is number of man, the number of man. And his number is 666. 666. Now, see, if you wait for the Antichrist to come, before you prepare your freezer to where you gonna start for 5 months, then prophecy don't do you no good. Because it ain't preparing you. If you put all your eggs in one drop, and God done told you you ain't gonna be able to buy or sell when that joker in the earth realm, you ain't listening. Huh? Because even I can go get an old can of pumpkin beans and I'm gonna eat. So I ain't gonna have to take no more, because God is already preparing my mind, sealed my mind with understanding that leading up to Jesus returning to the earth is gonna be the most severe time that the earth has ever seen. And approaching that day is the days of Noah, which was the fallen angels and plumb evilness, and the days of Lot, which was homosexuality, Luke 17. So now, I hope I have helped you in your understanding of how Jesus is coming back to the earth, what he's going to do when he comes back to the earth from the biblical point of view. Not from what my denomination said, not from what my pastor said, but from the biblical point of view. Because we outlined it in more than one place. This is Pastor Samson. Have a blessed day.